Do you recognise this face? Police in Melbourne are hunting this man after an unprovoked attack outside a fast food restaurant last month. The assault left the 49-year-old male victim unconscious and with a shattered cheek that required reconstructive surgery. Anyone who witnessed the incident or who has information is urged to give police a call. The New South Wales Government is in crisis mode this morning. Deputy Liberal Leader Stuart Ayres has defended his actions over the appointment of former Deputy Premier John Barilaro to a trade role in the US. Meanwhile, Minister Eleni Pitinos has been sacked over allegations of bullying. To unpack it all, I'm joined by Chris O'Keefe this morning. Chris, let's start with Stuart Ayres. What's he said about all this?
Well, he's the trade minister and he's the bloke who's in charge of essentially appointing John Barilaro, the former deputy premier, to a trade post in New York City, a $500,000 trade post. Now, John Barilaro has since pulled out, but there are questions within the government now, the New South Wales government, about whether or not Stuart Ayres can keep his job, given document after document after document has suggested that he had his hands all over this process. Now, that's something that Minister Ayres flatly denies, and he says the entire process has been held at arm's length. But then today, more documents have been released that show that Stuart Ayres himself, he admitted that he texted John Barilaro the job application to get that trade posting in New York. And then there's documents today that shows that John Barilaro wasn't even the preferred candidate, or he didn't get the highest score in the recruitment process to land the job in the first place. Instead, he was given the job and then he had a second lot of essentially recruitment process that changed some of the scores that he got to allow him to become number one on that list. So it's all very, very, very murky. Stuart Ayres, though, he is saying, regardless of what his colleagues are saying in the shadows at the moment, he is not standing down.
Well, I've not done anything wrong. There is no reason for me to stand aside. I've tried to say time and time again that the recruitment of senior trade and investment commissioners has been a role explicitly for the public service. I was not involved in this recruitment process. I was not involved in the selection panel. I wasn't engaged in the writing of any of those reports.
Yeah, he sounds pretty firm on that. And the Premier has also sacked his Minister for Small Business, Eleni Pitinos, after this anonymous complaint.
So there's been an anonymous complaint from her office around bullying, the way she treated her staff. Now, there has been multiple people in the Member for Miranda and the Fair Trading Minister's office who have since left, as supposedly, allegedly, as a result of her behaviour towards them. Now, Dominic Perrottet, the Premier, only a couple of days ago was standing by his embattled minister. He has then made a phone call, I'm told, to somebody in the department, and that person has said that it's not just ministerial staff that have alleged inappropriate behaviour by Ms. Pitinos, but departmental staff too. And that left the Premier, Dominic Perrottet, no choice. He simply said that it is not tenable for Eleni Pitinos to remain in the cabinet, and Lizzie, as a result, she has been sacked.
Okay, plenty going on. Thank you, Chris. Well, the consumer watchdog is urging the government to intervene in the gas market, warning a shortfall in supply will lead to further price hikes next year and put jobs at risk. Let's go live to federal politics reporter Fiona Whelan. Fee, what's the government expected to do?
Well, Lizzie, we're about to learn the government's next steps in tackling this crisis. So the Resources Minister is speaking in Canberra this morning in response to the findings of this report. The consumer watchdog, the ACCC, has warned Australia is heading for its biggest gas shortfall since 2017 next year, saying the outlook for the East Coast has significantly worsened, partially blaming the fact that much of our gas is sent overseas at higher prices, leaving the domestic market short. Now, it's projecting a shortage of 10% on the East Coast, arguing this could push up prices even further and potentially force some businesses to close. It's recommending that the government consider intervening. Now, the Commonwealth could potentially use an emergency measure known as the gas trigger, which would force exporters to reserve more supply for domestic use.
The ACCC are raising concerns about the supply-demand balance in the East Coast gas market in the coming year. They are serious concerns, but they are also pointing to the mechanisms that may be used to manage and resolve those.
The government has to seriously look at pulling the gas trigger, but the first step they should take is get all the gas producers in Australia in the one room and say, we need more gas.
Now, the gas industry has moved to reassure customers that there will be adequate supply next year. It's released a statement saying there won't be a shortfall and it will act. And the Prime Minister has spoken on radio just a short time ago, indicating that he's open to working with industry on a solution. Lizzie?
Fiona Willing there in Canberra for us. And former Prime Minister Scott Morrison has this morning been sworn back into Parliament as an opposition MP. Standing at the dispatch box for the first time since the election, the member for Cook took the oath before crossing to the opposition benches, shaking hands with the party's new leader, Peter Dutton. In the Senate, not quite as seamless, controversial Greens Senator Lydia Thorpe putting her own spin on her swearing in.
I bear true allegiance to the colonising Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II.
Senator Thorpe, you are required to recite the oath as printed on the card, so please recite the oath.
It's not the first time the Green Senator has drawn controversy, previously describing the Australian flag as a symbol of dispossession, massacre and genocide. A Queensland mayor has faced court this morning after crashing a council-owned vehicle into a tree while three times over the legal alcohol limit. Let's go live to Meg Sides in Brisbane. Meg, the mayor has just pleaded guilty.
That's right. We've just left the Cleveland court where Karen Williams pled guilty to one count of drink driving. Now, the Redlands mayor came under fire just over a month ago when she crashed her car drink driving shortly after having a meeting with families who'd lost loved ones to drink drivers. Now, today she was disqualified from driving for 6 months and ordered to undertake 80 hours of community service, described to her by the magistrate as an opportunity for her to claw back some of her dignity. Now, she was met outside council today, outside the court today, by a small group of protesters calling for her to resign from her position on council.
I know I have hard work to do, and I will regain that trust as I return to work later this week.
And while Karen Williams did apologise in her statement to the media today, she refused to take questions on whether she believes her position on council is still tenable. Lizzie?
OK, Meg Sides reporting there for us. Families are right now rallying outside a Victorian private school after it fell into voluntary administration, displacing hundreds of children from grades 3 to 10. With no classrooms available to accommodate them at Colmont in the town of Kilmore, parents are taking on teaching duties themselves. 100 families gathering outside the school gates, holding lessons in the cold.
Come last Wednesday night at 6 o'clock when we got the email that the school was closing on Friday. That's a very traumatic situation and a very big change for our whole family structure.
Parents will take their plight to the state government on Wednesday. A brawl has erupted in Sydney's inner west outside a Sydney FC and Central Coast Mariners football match. Ruth Wynne-Williams has the details.
Spectators were forced to take cover back inside the stadium last night as tensions escalated between a group of hooded men as the football game came to a close. This angry group out in the stadium car park arming themselves with makeshift weapons, throwing metal poles and other items along the street, even lighting flares and throwing those as they yelled at each other and faced off. The crowd was so heated and out of control, the riot squad was called to bring them into line. Witnesses say it was confronting for families, many with young children all caught up inside.
There was noises, there was cops, it was going off. There was no security.
It was an ugly end to the football match between Sydney FC and the Central Coast Mariners. Fans say this group was not made up of supporters from either club, but they have been critical of security efforts. Guards can be seen doing little to stop the brawl as it breaks. And spectators have told Nine News there was little instructions for fans about how to stay safe. Police are now reviewing security vision and calling for witnesses to help identify anyone involved in this stoush.
A dire warning about the property market today. A new report finding house prices in Australia are dropping at their fastest rate since the global financial crisis. Median property values are down 2% since the beginning of May to $747,000. In July, Sydney recorded a 2.2% fall. That's the sharpest downturn in almost 40 years. Melbourne dropped 1.5%, Brisbane 0.8%. Adelaide and Perth are recording the lowest falls across the country. country. Well, you wouldn't expect to fork out this much on a Maccas run. A passenger at Darwin Airport has copped nearly a $3,000 fine for trying to bring McMuffins into the country. Darwin's new detector dog, Zinta, sniffed out two undeclared egg and sausage McMuffins from McDonald's in Bali, as well as a ham croissant. The seized meat products will be tested for foot and mouth livestock disease before they are destroyed. And it turns out the fine is twice the cost of an airfare to Bali. Part of the Port of Beirut silos has collapsed this morning, leaving a plume of smoke from the damaged structure. A fire had been burning slowly in the ruins of the port's grain silos recently, giving off an orange glow visible at night from nearby neighbourhoods. The collapse comes almost 2 years to the day since a massive chemical explosion at the Beirut port killed more than 200 people. Boris Johnson lost his role as PM because of his love for a party, which hasn't stopped, even though he's now out of a job. Boris and wife Carrie have held a party at an estate in the Cotswolds to celebrate their wedding last year. The couple married in a low-key private ceremony at Westminster Cathedral due to COVID restrictions. Princess Charlotte has appeared in a very sweet video with her father, Prince William, the pair sending well wishes to England's women's soccer team before the Euro 2022 final.
We both want to wish the Lionesses the best of luck for tonight. You've done amazingly well in the competition and we're rooting for you all the way.
Good luck. I hope you win. Bye.
The Lionesses, seemingly spurred on by their royal cheer squad, went on to land an historic win, beating Germany 2-1 in extra time. It's the country's first major trophy since the men's side won the World Cup in 1966. Meanwhile, Kate Middleton is hitting the high seas. The Duchess of Cambridge dropped into the historic naval town of Plymouth to take part in a friendly Commonwealth race around the coast of England. Aussie sailing champion Tom Slingsby showing her the ropes before she hit the water with the Great Britain Grand Prix team.